As soon as there were any lasers at all, the science fiction writers, or television reporters as they're sometimes known, thought this must be some kind of a death ray.
Laser, a science fiction dream come true. With it, the death ray has arrived, but it also may well become the dynamo of the 21st century. 21st century skips
on. The dynamo, of course, led to the electrical power industry, to radio, electronics, television. And it's very clear now, after about 18 years of the laser, that it's going to have the same profound influence on life in the 21st century.
Lasers seem to be turning up everywhere, even in the local supermarket, although the manager may be reluctant to admit it.
Well, I'm the only one that knows, to my knowledge at least, that a laser beam is contained in that machine. I wouldn't want to mention the word laser at this particular stage of the game because of the fact that lasers are new. But in actual fact, of course, it is a laser that is controlled. It has its safety features, and it must have gone through all government tests before they even thought of installing them in any kind of a place like a supermarket.
But this laser is no death ray. It simply scans the product codes on your shopping and tells the computer what you've bought. And it's all done by less than a thousandth of a watt of light. So what is a laser? Well, it's not like ordinary light. If you could hear the light from this flashlight, it might sound like this. A jumble of different pitches or wavelengths. But this is how a laser might sound. Its color is very pure, and the light waves are completely regular. It's called coherent light. So important has this invention been that museums vie for the claim to have the first laser. But the original is in Los Angeles, in the hands of its inventor, Dr. Theodore Maiman.
Well, this is an object of extreme historical interest. This device happens to be the original laser. This particular little piece of apparatus produced the first coherent light ever made.
It looks simple, but there's complex physics behind it. The heart of the laser is this red crystal made of synthetic ruby. Like many crystals, ruby is slightly fluorescent. On each end is a mirror, one of which is half silvered. Maiman put the ruby inside a photographer's flash lamp, and the laser was born. The ruby atoms were able to store up the energy from the flash. Immediately, a few atoms released their stored energy as fluorescence. Most of it escaped through the sides of the crystal. But the light released along the length of the ruby hit further atoms, stimulating them to emit their light. Quickly, the intensity built up between the two mirrors. Similar atoms always emit light of the same wavelength or color. This method of stimulating emission ensured that the individual emissions always reinforced each other. The whole process only took fractions of a second, until finally a burst of light passed out through the half-silvered mirror. It was a parallel coherent beam, all its light concentrated in regular waves of one single wavelength. Maiman's ruby could only flash briefly, but its coherence made it the purest light in the world. It's an achievement he's proud to celebrate.
It was in the spring of 1960 that the first laser light was emitted from this device, of course. And now that we are here 18 years later, we can think of the laser as having come of age.
But though Maiman made the first laser, these men are credited with inventing it.
Well, the patent is in the name of Shallow and myself.
Professors Shallow and Towns hold the basic patent on the laser because they thought of the idea first.
Well, the ideas behind the laser began to take real form in 1957, 1958, actually. Art Shallow and I were working together at that time, and we both had some somewhat parallel ideas, so we pulled them.
Well, it really goes back to the maser, which Professor Towns invented in 1951, and which he and his students actually operated in 1954.
We call it microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, the word maser, the acronym maser.
It was Charles Towns' maser, a microwave amplifier, that led to the concept and the name of the laser, a light amplifier. The paper he wrote in 1958 with Arthur Shallow was historic. It contained the basic design of a laser, but they couldn't make one work. The race was on. Millions of dollars were spent by universities and major corporations in the search for a device that would actually lase. The winner at Hughes Aircraft was Maiman with the ruby flash lamp combination. It had taken him 18 months extra research, but the basic laser patent remains with Shallow and Towns. Within a few months, another type of laser appeared. This one was made of gas, a mixture of helium and neon, and the atoms were excited not with a flash lamp, but electricity. It was the first laser to produce a continuous beam. Suddenly, people found almost anything would lase. Krypton gas with a red beam. And lasers made of argon. Each gas had its own specific wavelength. Today, laser manufacture has grown into a billion-dollar business. And yet, when lasers were first invented, nobody could think of what to do with them. They were described as a solution looking for a problem. One of the first applications was in surveying. The laser's narrow beam made an excellent leveling device. And so lasers have been widely taken up by the construction industry. On completed structures, a laser can tell you how well it's standing up to the strain. Vulnerable stress points can be monitored. But scientific laboratories knew the laser was more useful.
Setting line five.
Line five.
Ready?
Now.
Because of the laser's coherent wavelength, it can be used to measure distances to incredible accuracy. In fact, to the length of half a wave of light. And that means an accuracy of a millionth of a centimeter. So now, to measure between two points, you can simply count the number of light waves you've traveled. In fact, The laser is now making laboratories rethink all their past definitions of accuracy. The National Physical Laboratory in London is one such official keeper of standards. One of their jobs is to measure the highest speed in the universe, the speed of light.
You all right?
Fine, you bit.
Jumping around a lot.
Fine now.
I've got you in the terms, all right?
The speed of light has been known for years, but now it can be measured with enormous accuracy using a series of precisely tuned lasers.
CO2 laser in lock.
Speed's fine now.
I've got a good signal here now.
Okay, counting now.
HDN lock was good.
For Dr. Rowley and his team, the speed of light, as measured by laser, is now officially
186,282.397 miles per second. With this extra accuracy, certain measurements of long distances, for example, the distance from the Earth to the Moon, can now be specified to an uncertainty of about 1 foot.
Astronauts had left a mirror on the Moon for just that purpose. Across a quarter of a million miles of space, the laser beam spreads only 2 miles over the surface. For scientists, the laser is pushing back the frontiers of knowledge in all directions. At Bell Laboratories in New Jersey, Dr. Peter Rentsepas.
We are very, very excited with the capabilities of the laser, because at the present time, the laser can provide us with very, very narrow wavelengths of light, which enable us to really probe the heart of matter, specific parts of matter, and therefore understand what's going on in areas which were not available to us by any other means that I know of.
To do their probing into matter, scientists have come up with a rather special laser. The heart of it is this liquid dye, which can produce light of virtually any color, and that means any wavelength. It's become a major tool for the pure scientist interested in probing the resonant frequencies, say, of a hydrogen atom. Atomic spectroscopy. And then there are pulsed lasers. Some of them have flashes that last for less than a millionth of a millionth of a second. They are the shortest man-made events on Earth.
To give you an idea how short those pulses are, if you take the light traveling for 1 second, it would be 186,000 miles, I think. The pulses would generate, they are about a tenth of a millimeter in duration. We are excited about it, not because of that, but we can use those pulses to freeze a molecular event while it takes place. Like, for instance, when now that you are looking at me, an event takes place in your eye. We can freeze it.
They take an extract of the pigment in the eye and fire a string of tiny pulses at it. And they find that our eyes respond to light in just 6 millionths of a millionth of a second. After a slow start, the world of commerce has begun to see the laser's potential. This is a video disc. It's just like a phonograph record, except that the grooves are made of tiny angled pits and bumps, which are a coded television signal. And instead of a stylus, there's a laser buried in the player. Because laser light is so uniform, the way it's reflected from each groove gives a perfect image of the surface. Laser high fidelity.
And I know that this must be heaven. How could so much love...
And if a laser can read, why shouldn't it write?
Good morning, Orange County. I have a page for you to be transmitted on Laserite 102. That's your 101.
Ready on this end.
Okay, I'm going to load page 34, part 1.
At the Los Angeles Times, they now use lasers to transmit every page to printing presses throughout California.
Here it comes.
Transmission okay.
A helium neon laser reads the page, and at the other end of the telephone line, an argon laser writes it. It produces a perfect negative of the original page. And it's meant the death of this. Because at the Los Angeles Times, the old hot type process is now a museum piece. The computer and the laser have been twins in the revolution. The computer types the stories. The compositors set it out. And the paste-up is read by laser. It's a beautiful marriage of electronics and photonics, the new science of light. Was, of course, inevitable that sooner or later the laser would find its way into battle. There's a laser on this tank. Its beam is infrared, invisible to the enemy. Gunners use it for range finding. It sends out invisible pulses, which when returned give a range figure so accurate that it's secret. With a laser, you just cannot miss. The infantryman, too, now has a laser. No, it's not a ray gun, but it's potentially as lethal. It's called a target designator. Again, its beam is invisible, but as it strikes the enemy, the scattered light can be picked up for miles around. Your foe is a marked man. Slung under the nose of aircraft are sensors designed to detect the specific laser wavelength and home in on it. In the cockpit, a head-up display pinpoints the target. And the coup de grace is delivered with a laser-seeking missile. The accuracy of laser-guided weapons has transformed conventional warfare. But there's more to military lasers than this. At Aviation Week magazine, Philip Klass.
The concept of the laser was first proposed in the late 1950s, even before one had been successfully built or constructed. There was military interest in the laser as a potential, we'll call it a death ray, that's the popular terminology, because in theory, one could package and deliver a large amount of energy in a very, very tiny beam of light.
When James Bond confronted the death ray in 1963, there were no lasers that powerful. But only the following year at Bell Laboratories, Dr. Kumar Patel came up with one. He he began experimenting with a new gas laser using carbon dioxide. Within a few years, they were giants. Patel had found the way to high power by circulating the lasing gas at high pressure down the electrical discharge tubes. It kept down the heat and stepped up the power rating into thousands of watts. Its beam was invisible, but this was its effect on oak. A fire brick pierced in 3 seconds. Granite. Fifteen kilowatts of coherent light can melt almost everything in its path. Industry seized on it as a precision welder. It could harden metal surfaces by selective heat treating. And form new metal alloys directly on the surface. It makes an ideal partner for the new robots in car assembly plants. Its beam can be focused to the width of a few wavelengths of light. It set new standards of precision. For the clothing trade, it can cut 50 suits at a time with no frayed edges. In fact, the list of uses is almost endless. But meanwhile, the military has been hard at work. Recently, they released details of a laser 10 times more powerful than anyone had seen in industry. And then they issued this. A film of a tank, equipped not with a gun, but a high-power laser. The laser exit port is in the protective dome on the top. The details of the laser's purpose and power are classified, but it's likely that it's being tested against aircraft and low-flying missiles. They also admit to another laser weapon mounted in an aircraft. We approached the Pentagon for an interview about their laser weaponry, but were politely refused. So we went back to Aviation Week correspondent Philip Klass.
Well, as a weapon, the laser offers several potential advantages. One is the idea that one can steer it instantly or very quickly and zap a number of targets much more rapidly than one could hope to launch individual missiles. The second thing is that the beam travels at 186,000 miles a second, almost instantaneously. So one does not need to lead the target as a hunter does when he's shooting at ducks, because the target will move almost no distance at all before the beam gets up there.
And how powerful might military lasers be?
I would guess, and I'm only guessing, that probably today we're working with lasers that are maybe several hundred thousand kilowatts continuous power. Maybe as high as 1,000,000 watts, but I'm doubtful of that. But if one can apply that much energy at close range, say several miles, a few kilometers, it is possible to burn a hole if one can concentrate that into a small beam.
A 100,000 kilowatts? Well, this is just 10 kilowatts on an 8-inch block of plexiglass. But making a death ray work seems to have had its problems. As you increase the power levels to get maximum penetration, the beam is blocked by its own impact. This is what happens on steel in slow motion. As the laser strikes the surface, the metal vaporizes and forms a plasma. This plasma blocks the beam and effectively cuts off the power. So the military now pulse their lasers. It has a completely different effect. Instead of melting metal, a pulse produces a shockwave inside it. In slow motion, it literally blows the metal apart. But pulsing has problems of its own. Along a focused beam, the air itself electrifies. Another ball of plasma to frustrate the beam. And then there's beam spreading, caused by the refraction in the hot atmosphere. But the military have a solution. They now use a low-power laser to monitor the effect of the high-power laser on the target. If the beam starts to defocus, that information is instantly fed back to a flexible mirror controlling the main laser. So when there's spreading, the mirror refocuses to compensate. The death ray seems a reality.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, fire!
This is part of the research laboratories of the Avco Corporation in Boston. They develop many of the military lasers. It was virtually all we were allowed to see of the Pentagon's $150 million high-energy laser program.
Kenny, are ready to charge with the mercury chloride?
Yes.
New types of gases are being tested in search of higher efficiency. And there's a new type of exciter, a beam of electrons. They give added force to the laser pulse. Of course, these experimental lasers are mere babies compared to the top secret weaponry. But even these can pack 100 million watts per pulse.
2, 1.
A clue to the real power available to the military may come from an unusual experimental project. The idea is to use a laser to propel a rocket into space. At Avco, they've already done small-scale tests. Seen in slow motion, a series of laser pulses enters the rocket's base. Inside, a pocket of material instantly turns into a gas, which thrusts out of the back. Payloads could be put into orbit more cheaply because heavy chemical fuels are not needed. It's a massive laser. At present, only an artist's sketch. But the concept's being taken seriously. How far would the beam carry? Dr. Douglas Hamilton.
Well, about 1,000 kilometers, probably. And we believe that we can maintain the beam tight enough to do that for a distance of like 1,000 kilometers.
And how powerful would the laser be?
Very large. In order to put a ton into orbit, you would need about a gigawatt, which is 1,000 megawatts of power.
But do we at present have any lasers that gigantic?
No, we don't have any lasers as powerful as that. But we do have a method of scaling lasers, and we therefore have no limits on the size of lasers we could build.
So in theory, such lasers could be used to knock aircraft and missiles out of the sky. Pentagon documents now see the laser decisively affecting the balance of power, and especially in space. Satellites are now a crucial part of defense. They are the spies, the communicators, and by now a few are probably carrying lasers. Because space is a vacuum, a laser beam can travel unhindered for extreme distances at the speed of light. Already there have been rumors of U.S. satellites being disabled by Russian lasers. and the Pentagon has announced it's now protecting satellites against laser attack. Because spacecraft have vulnerable parts, solar panels, electronics, and particularly their optics. At the United Technologies Research Center in Connecticut, we were able to see some of the kinds of lasers now being developed for war in space.
Sir, may I see your badges, please?
For the military scientists, making a laser work in space is not that easy. On board a satellite, electric power is limited, and large payloads are expensive. So the problem has been to make a small, high-power laser that uses no electricity. The solution is a laser like this, a chemical laser. All it needs are two bottles of highly reactive chemicals, hydrogen and fluorine. When mixed together, they react so vigorously that the atoms start to lase. Last year, the Pentagon announced that chemical lasers had reached, quote, useful efficiencies. 21st century war may now begin.
Operating team, stand by. We are now energizing the laser.
It was perhaps inevitable that, like the military, the medical profession would also want a slice of the laser action. Using lasers as a surgical knife has obvious advantages. It's bloodless for a start. The sheer heat of the laser, 5,600 degrees, will cauterize any obstinate blood vessels. So it's useful in particularly bloody operations in places like the liver. The laser doesn't cut, it vaporizes, literally boiling the flesh. And yet, microscope analysis shows it affects only a millimeter of the surrounding tissue. But on tumors, lasers can let rip, and infected tissue vanishes into harmless vapor. And there's a bonus. The sheer heat ensures absolute sterility. So now, some doctors feel that it's in cancer surgery that the laser may be of most value, especially in inaccessible areas of the body. This is a laser operation on a small cancerous growth 10 inches inside the lower colon. The green light is from an argon laser, used simply for alignment. The power comes from a carbon dioxide laser. Because the cut is both sterile and instantly cauterized, it reduces the chance of cancerous cells spreading through the body. And there are cosmetic lasers. Skin blemishes like this tattoo can be removed because dark areas absorb the laser light, leaving the lighter skin untouched. Results like this have encouraged some surgeons to try the laser on more serious cosmetic problems. In particular, the deep red birthmarks that can occur on the face and neck. They're using a pulsed laser, producing high peak power in short bursts. Although the results appear encouraging, the technique is still experimental, and only a handful of doctors are using it. But in one area, at least, the laser is firmly established, and that is for surgery of the retina. For over 10 years, ophthalmologists have been routinely treating two major eye problems with laser beams. A detached retina can literally be spot welded back into place. Blood vessels in danger of hemorrhaging can be cauterized. In fact, for complaints like these, the laser is often the only answer. So refined has laser surgery become that it's now getting down to the cellular level. It can be focused to destroy a single cell. Already, lasers can, experimentally, detect malignant cells in the blood and destroy them. No target is too small, not even part of a cell. Microsurgery like this may well be a tool for cancer and genetic research for the 21st century. One 21st century dream has already come true. Pictures in three dimensions. Three dimensions recorded on a flat photographic plate, lit by a laser. They're called holograms, but they're still just sheets of glass. Left to pick up the pieces, you'll notice something strange. The whole image is still there. In fact, every single piece contains a full 3D image, but from a different point of view. To make a hologram, this is what you do. Take a laser beam and split it in two. Bend them around. In one beam, place your object. Then spread the beams out. The light from one laser beam is reflected from the object onto an ordinary photographic plate. There's no lens. Also shining on the plate is the other beam, called the reference beam. After a second or two's exposure, the plate is developed in the normal way. When you hold it up to the light, there's nothing there. But under a microscope, the plate has a granular pattern where the light waves from each laser beam have met and combined. To decode the pattern, you need the original reference beam, and it will reconstruct the entire scene exactly as before. The original wave front from the object is regenerated, so it appears real. Holograms can now give scientists very accurate measurements. This is a hologram of a soup bowl, and here's the original scene. If you put the hologram back in its original position, an interesting effect occurs. A slight squeeze of the dish will produce these fringes of light. They appear because the light waves from the dish are now interfering with the hologram. Each fringe represents a movement of half a wavelength of light, about a millionth of a centimeter. It's been taken up by industry. You can exactly measure the stresses produced when a car engine is bolted down. Aircraft wings have been tested. A slight heating can show up flaws in the structure. Using a pulsed laser, rapid events can be recorded. This is how a crash helmet behaves under stress. You can also see how it affects the head and neck of the wearer and his feet. Recently, holography has begun to take off. At Loughborough University, some of the world's largest holograms are now being made by a team under Nicholas Phillips. New emulsions and developing techniques have produced some of the clearest and most realistic holograms yet, and of great depth. The far object appears to be 10 feet behind the plate. Some of the results have been stunning. This hologram of a hand lens in front of some bottles is an example of what's called a real image hologram. The hand lens appears to be standing out from the plate, and it functions as if it really were a magnifying glass. And now you can view holograms without a laser. A technique developed in Russia has made holograms viewable in ordinary light by reflecting it off the surface. At Loughborough, they're perfecting the technique because it promises to produce the first holograms in color. Nick Phillips.
Well, the novel feature of this particular hologram that I'm showing here is that it was recorded by a green argon laser, and the viewer will clearly see that it's being played back as a green image when lit with a white bulb. So there is some correspondence between the wavelength at which the hologram was recorded and the wavelength at which it appears to play back.
So now he's experimenting with holograms containing three emulsions, each sensitive to one primary color. He's not revealing the details of the process, but success is not far off.
Within probably the next year, maybe 2 years, we shall see an image recorded by three colored laser beams, blue, green, and red, which when played back will recreate a blue, green, and red image, giving the viewer the illusion of a full color, three-dimensional picture.
Three-dimensional movies. This rotating surface is made up of hundreds of minute vertical lines, each one a different hologram. It gives an impression of movement in three dimensions. The colors are a prismatic artifact and not realistic. Nevertheless, it's a start. From Russia, the first real 3D movie using holographic film. But 3D movies won't come tomorrow. After years of research, the results are still unsophisticated. The angle of viewing is so critical that the effect can be seen by four people at most. There's a long way to go. But down manholes, the laser is making telephone companies around the world do a complete rewiring job. Why? Because they think we'll be telephoning by laser. Using light for communication has enormous advantages. Light waves, being so short, can carry thousands of times more information than conventional methods. For years, the idea remained a dream, until they made lasers like these. Pass a small current through it, and it will begin to lase, pulsing millions of times a second. Each pulse a potential information carrier. And the way to transmit the light? Through glass fibers. In the last few years, a revolution has occurred in glass fiber technology. Fibers have been developed of glass so transparent that light will travel through it for 2 or 3 miles with very little loss of output. Communicating by light is a cheap, practical reality. It's predicted that by the year 2000, laser telephone traffic could have increased a millionfold and take up less cable space than conventional and expensive copper. And having satisfied our communication needs, the laser may solve our energy problems with atomic fusion. Dr. Philip Coyle.
Shortly after the laser was invented, we realized that it had a fantastic ability to compress energy and to create temperatures like those in the center of the sun. And that's what's needed for fusion. Fusion is the process that makes the energy in the sun and the stars. But to make it happen here on Earth, we need a driving source which can create those same kinds of temperatures.
At Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in California, this giant laser was one of the first built to try and achieve the temperatures of the center of the sun. It's a pulsed laser, giving out only a few milliwatts in pulses of a billionth of a second. One pulse is selected and sent down a series of amplifiers. And by journey's end, it reaches a power of a trillion watts, all directed at this. A tiny pellet of deuterium and tritium, the fusion fuel. On it, two beams converge, producing a temperature of 100 million degrees. The laser system works, but that's just a beginning.
The problem is that in spite of these huge laser systems that we have, we still haven't gotten as back as much energy from the target as we've put in with the laser. To do that is going to take even more powerful lasers such as Shiva, which is operational now.
Shiva is a giant. It's the largest laser in the world. Its amplifiers can produce up to 40 trillion watts. Split into 24 separate beams, the target chamber will receive 10 times more power than before. But that will only produce a fusion output equal to the laser input. Fusion may seem a pipe dream, but now they're planning an even bigger laser, Shiva Nova, with another tenfold increase in power. And it's said this will produce a favorable energy equation. Ultimately, they do foresee a fusion power station powered by laser. It should be safer than orthodox nuclear power, and the fuel's much cheaper. But if it arrives, it will be only one of the laser's contributions to life in the 21st century. Professor Dan Bradley.
It is clear that the laser is going to play a key role in the everyday life and industry of the 21st century. Indeed, one of the problems is that we may not be able to train the skilled people we need if the laser industry grows as rapidly in the future as it is now. Because there's a whole new science being invented, which is comparable to electronics, but which will be called photonics.
The laser has opened up a truly vast field of applications. There's talk of laser alchemy, lasers that penetrate matter, break molecular bonds, and make new chemical compounds. Already, lasers are separating uranium isotopes, and drugs of great purity are promised. The laser was once called a solution looking for a problem. Who knows what problems it may solve in the 21st century?